to Ogongo TV. This is Medical Tips. Today, I want to discuss with you things that you need to know about sickle cell disease. Please, if you have not subscribed to this channel, I want you to do that. And don't forget to click on the notification bell so that anytime we upload new content, you'll be notified. Thank you for doing that. Yes, things you need to know about sickle cell disease. Of course, you know that sickle cell disease is a blood problem. And the blood majorly consists of three components: the red blood cells, the white blood cells, and the platelets. The responsibility of the red blood cells is to transport oxygen and glucose from one part of the body to the other. And the responsibility of the white blood cells is to serve as the immune system for the body. The platelet performs the function of preventing bleeding. Now, adult red blood cell is what we are focusing on. And the adult red blood cell consists mainly of the hemoglobin A and a small amount of hemoglobin A2 and fetal hemoglobin. Hemoglobin A is our focus. Adult red blood cell, the normal hemoglobin is hemoglobin A. But in a situation where there is an abnormality, when there is a mutation at one point, for example, the hemoglobin is consist of beta chain and alpha chain. On this beta chain, there are amino acids that are positioned at different points. At position number 6, the normal amino acid is glutamic acid. But when there is an abnormality, when there is a genetic disorder that causes a mutation in which the normal glutamic acid is removed and replaced with valine, the hemoglobin that will be formed will be hemoglobin S. But in a case where it is replaced by lysine, it will form hemoglobin C. Both hemoglobin S and hemoglobin C are normal hemoglobin. The normal hemoglobin is hemoglobin A. But everybody has two hemoglobins. It can be hemoglobin A and hemoglobin A, which we call hemoglobin AA. It can be hemoglobin A and hemoglobin C, and that is AC. It can be hemoglobin C and hemoglobin C, that is CC. It can be hemoglobin A and hemoglobin S, that is AS. It can be hemoglobin S and hemoglobin S, that is SS. How do we generate these hemoglobins? It is gotten from our parents. It depends on what our parents carry. Our parents can be hemoglobin AA and hemoglobin AC, or hemoglobin AC and hemoglobin AA, or hemoglobin AC and hemoglobin SC. Like that. The point I'm making is, it depends on what our father and our mother donate. If the father donate A and the mother donate S, the child will be AS. If the father is AS and the mother is AS, in a situation where the father donate that S and the mother too donate that S, the child will be SS. If the father donates C and the mother donates S, the child will be SC. If the mother donates A and the father donates A, the child will be A. Like that. It depends on what they donate. And we don't have control over what we donate. We don't have control over what we get. It is the gene. It's not controllable. Okay? Hemoglobin SS, SC, and CC are the people with sickle cell problems. Those are people that really have sickle cell anemia. Why do we call it sickle cell? The sickle cell, because once there is a mutation on this globin chain, the red blood cell finds it so easy to form aggregation and polymerization and develop a shape that is sickle in appearance. And with this, it finds it difficult to move with ease in the blood vessels that are tiny, the capillaries. So what do? Easily they can occlude those blood vessels, not allowing blood to pass through with ease. When a child is born and he has hemoglobinopathy, I mean, it comes with hemoglobin SS or CC or SC, symptoms can begin to manifest from 3 to 6 months. And usually, the first thing you notice is swelling in both hands and legs, dactylitis. Alright, when you see this, at the age of maybe 3 months or 6 months, just look at your child, notice that there's an unnecessary swelling in both hands and the legs without any cause. Find out that child can be SS or CC or SC. Usually, patients with these problems comes up with a lot of problems, ranging from recurrent low blood level, which is anemia. Because of the shape of the red blood cells, the red blood cell finds it difficult to move freely, especially when there is deoxygenation. So this blood cell lies with ease. When you check for their PCV, packed cell volume, it's usually low. And because of this problem, most of them usually have jaundice, they have yellowness in their conjunctiva. Look at their eyes, it's yellow. They have recurrent vaso-occlusive problems. Most times, this causes a lot of pains. They have pains all over the body, in the bones, in their extremities. They can develop pains in the chest. They can recurrent infection, recurrent sickness, low immune system. When they have wound in their body, it doesn't heal on time. Some of them can have poor growth. When you see some, you see the appearance on them. Okay, some of them have come down with prolonged erection. Okay, it's a big problem, but it should be a concern for everybody. So how do we avoid having babies with hemoglobin SS or CC or SC? How do we avoid that? Number one, avoidance of marriage between somebody who has a trait and another person who has a trait. Meaning that if you have a trait of sickle cell, maybe hemoglobin 1, hemoglobin S in your gene, or you have hemoglobin C, you should not get married to another person who has that trait. Apart from avoiding marriage between people who have traits, prenatal diagnosis can also be made. And this is a situation where a sample will be taken from the baby in the womb, will be subjected to tests. If it is going to be hemoglobin SS, CC or SC, it will be known. And such baby can be legally terminated. Well, in a situation where a baby with sickle cell anemia has been born. How do we manage this baby? How do you handle this baby? It can be frustrating. It can be frustrating. Imagine somebody who has a 2 hemoglobin SS patient under his roof. It can be frustrating because of the rate at which it can be falling sick. But the truth is that if you manage them well, you can reduce all this. There are things that you can put in place. There are measures that you can put in place that will increase the immune system, increase the immunity of these children, and will make them, you know, fit for activity. Now, proper feeding is necessary. Balanced diet, reduce their stress, let them understand their genotype, and then you take them away from different kind of stress. Don't allow mosquito bites to put in the net. Cover the window and the door with the net. They should be compliant with their medications. And very important, they should take water very well and fruit very well. But the good news is, presently, there's a cure for sickle cell anemia. What is that cure? Bone marrow transplant. Bone marrow transplant. You know, blood is produced by the bone marrow. And whatever the bone marrow is producing depends on the genetic formation of the bone marrow. Presently, bone marrow can be transplanted. Presently, bone marrow, if transplanted, can create a cure for sickle cell anemia, but that is not found everywhere, you know, and it is costly. Please, I want you to go with this point. Number one, if you have children with sickle cell problems at home, they should be compliant with their medications. Number two, let them take water adequately, fruit adequately, and they should have adequate rest. Number three, inform them about their condition and the importance of avoiding stressful activities. Apart from the fact that these will help them to increase their immunity in cases like sickle cell anemia, it will also help them to channel their energy towards reading and other non-physical activities, intellectual activities. I believe you have learned one or two things from this discussion. Please, if you have not subscribed to this channel, I want you to do that. Thank you so much. I'd like you to stay safe. I want you to stay healthy. Knowledge is wealth. Health is wealth. I love you.